In high school, there were four of us that were friends, and we met at the out downstairs or out a block away from the school, and we graduated from St. Patrick's Cathedral. And so before we went over to into our classroom, we used to wear hats and gloves in those days. The four of us decided to go into a Child's restaurant, which is a inexpensive chain place back in those days, and we ordered a Tom Collins. And now, I guess that some of them were 18, I was 17, and we felt so naughty because we thought, oh, if sister ever saw us or ever smelled us, but
Wait,
Tom Collins,
what is a Tom
a
Collins?
Tom Collins, I think, is gin and something else, but this was kind of a weak drink out of a tall glass. And I think you'd have a straw and what, cherry and so forth. So anyhow, but I graduated. But yeah, I couldn't. After I was working in Bell Labs, and my aunt had moved to her own apartment, she had not. She was not married, and she was hanging out mostly with married friends and playing cards and stuff. And she was happy, and that was good for her. But I decided that was not. If I wasn't going to get married, that was not for me, because most of my friends had gotten married earlier than in their early 20s and stuff, especially with the war on. They got married before their husbands-to-be went overseas. So I went on vacation one time all by myself to the Poconos for a weekend. And what we normally did was, if we had met somebody and we had a date, we would ask them if they had a friend. We never went out. Solo was always double date. Well, anyhow, so I also took up smoking, because you can sit in the lobby and smoke and look like that's what you're doing, rather than just sit in the lobby somewhere and kind of, look around. So that was it. And grandpa used to tease me because he'd say, he said, you're not inhaling, so I gave it up, because then I didn't need it. But this one guy, yeah, there were two guys there, and one of them saw a girl that he would like to take dancing. And he asked his friend if she would go, he would go with her friend, but he didn't really like her friend, so I didn't want to, he just said no. So I guess they found another guy or something, I don't know what, but this man, we started talking, and then we took a walk down about a block to a little country bar, and we just had, I think, two drinks and walked back up. And he came walking up to my room and opened the door, and I left it open. And he or he came in, I guess, and I left my door open. And I had used to read Esquire magazine, which was a man's magazine then, because they had good writers, and the New Yorker, and I had those on my bed, and he was starting to look at them. And then he started to go, and I took a cigarette out. He was older than I, so he might have thought it was so stupid, but I took a cigarette out and put it in my lips and walked him to the door of my room like this, so he wouldn't try to kiss me. He had no intention of it, actually. But it was just, but I did, I guess, took a Great Lakes tour by myself, and that was my decision to be on my, on my own, and not to hang out with my married friends and stuff. So I was a little bit ahead of my time, maybe, but because there were, and then, so from my, where was I coming from? My Great Lakes cruise, I guess, I was probably 24, and my brother had a friend who had a car, and they were going to pick me up at the airport, and we went, he had poison oak. His hands were all bandaged up, and they were clowns, the three of them. They would go through, they'd say, oh, that airplane crash is terrible, but your hands hurt, and people would look at them. But anyhow, the two, the people, it was my brother Phil, and our friend and his friend Mark and O'Hare and Bill Conrad. So got my suitcases and they walked upstairs and came in and sat for a while, and my mother called me out into the kitchen and she said, "Oh, I know, going home in the car, my brother and Mark were asking me about the trip and all that stuff, and this Bill Conrad who was driving and I was sitting next to him, he didn't say two words to me." So when we get and my mother called me in the kitchen and she said, "Why don't you talk to the Bill Conrad? He's a nice boy." And I said, "Mommy, stop paying attention to me, you know." So anyhow, then they got the three of the fellows left and they were going, I don't know where, somewhere. And we were our windows were in the front and they looked out to wave goodbye. And apparently I had left my coat in the car by accident, actually. And Mark had it. He was going to bring it up to me, and Bill had it. He wanted to bring it up, and it was my coat. And so I said, "Well, y'all, I'd come down and get it." And my aunt said, "I'll go get it." And I said, "No, I will go get it." And I looked in halfway, and it was Bill. And I guess thanked him for the ride, and then he said, "Well, a bunch of us are going out to Long Island dancing Saturday. Would you like to go?" And I said, "Sure." And my mother and I were about, my mother was only 22 old, years older than I, so we could almost swap clothes, except shoes. I had bigger feet. But anyhow, she had a black satin dress that I wore, and we went out to the, wherever it was, a club in Long Island, and there must have been about, I don't think Phil was there, maybe six or eight of us or something. And I don't know if he had a car. We came home, somebody, yes, he did have the car. So then he brought me home and asked me if I would like to go out next week to Jones Beach. So I said, "Sure." And he worked in Albans, my brother worked in Albans, and a lot of the kids that were had been the kids, young men had been were in the it had been in the service, worked in all as part time while they're going for their bachelor's degree or whatever they chose to be in for the GI Bill, and so we went out to Jones Beach and we had a couple ice cream sodas and taught me to how to play shoot arrow, bows and arrows and stuff like that. And this is really the silly part, sort of. He asked me to marry him. It was 2 dates. And I said yes. And then I was afraid, when I got home, I was afraid to tell my mother because she'd think I was crazy. Why did you do this? And what did he do? And all this. And so I didn't tell her. And then the following week, he called up and asked if I could come down and have lunch with him at Altman's, where they all worked. And he wanted to introduce me to some of his coworkers. So Saturday was house cleaning day. It was almost a day you don't get excused from. So I asked my mother, and she said yes, because she liked that he had been to our house when I wasn't there for. I think my brother and he were going to a party, and my mother said he bought, leather, white leather gloves for this girl. Okay, but I was somewhere else. I don't know where. Anyhow, so he started introducing me as his fiance, and I thought, well, I guess he meant it. So I, told my mother, and then that was she was she didn't seem so upset about it, but. It wasn't until we dated, but it was hard because he went to school at night. He worked in the daytime, and then they had a place called Chock Full of Nuts near NYU. And working in Altman's was good because they closed, I think, at 5 o'clock or something, and he could make the mad dash down on the subway, grab a bite of Chock Full of Nuts. I think for a quarter you could get like a cream cheese and raisin bread sandwich and a glass of milk and cooking for a quarter. So we, but we dated then, as you know, when we could, mostly on the weekends, and he would send me notes on his business card, you know, I love you and stuff like that. But then it was following Thanksgiving, I think it was, I don't have to think, that a friend of his that worked at Allman's, his sister went to school with me. We just found that. So anyhow, he was going to be the best man. He invited us to the wedding. So he came up to get me. You had to get married. If you wanted to get married from a mass, you had to get married at in the morning, and it was usually 10 o'clock on a Saturday. So he came to pick me up, and we were in the kitchen. My mother was back in the bedroom, I think, and she heard me. She was saying, oh, and she's wondering what was going on. She didn't know whether she should come out or what she should do. But she get, but he gave me a ring that he'd been saving for all year. He had gotten it through the jewelry department. He knew a friend there, and he had like paid it off and got it for Thanksgiving. But we couldn't get married till the following June, because of school. Actually, it was no, you know, he'd rather finish the terms that year, and that's a whole semester out. And but that was really, he had a 1941 red Buick, and the last car we owned together was a red Buick. But I, you know, later date, of course. But it was really, and so they had decorated the car, you know, as they do some, and we were going up to Maine, I think, and we got the decorations off it, and we stopped at one motel. It's really, we had the room had like a skeleton key, and if you wanted to service or something, you rang a bell on the door, on the wall. So anyhow, the next morning we got up and got dressed, and he went to open the door, and the key broke, and then we couldn't get out. And so we rang the buzzer, and you know, nobody answered. Somebody passed by, and we kind of, you know, said we were locked in, but nobody answered. Finally, somebody came and opened the door, and we went down and had breakfast. And everybody was like kind of giggling. We didn't realize that they had written on our tires, "Just married." So we thought we had gotten rid of everything, but it was really done on a kind of inexpensive scale, but nice. When we got to Maine, we had a cabin there, and we lay on the beach. It didn't seem real hot, but it was right on the ocean, and I guess with the breeze and stuff, we got a really bad sunburn. But we went to a playhouse that night for a play, and the next morning I woke up, and my legs were absolutely burned. Yeah, and his
Oof.
chest was burned.
Oof.
And so, but he went and got something, breakfast or something, and we decided to go there, leave there for cooler climate, you know. Then we went to Franconia Notch, and then came home early because we ran out of money. But it was really, the hard part for me was he had bought, well, his parents actually paid for that, bought the house on the GI Bill. And so when they were getting married, they fixed up the downstairs, which was the street entrance, and the main part of the house was up like a little flight of stairs. And she would kind of make coffee, you know, which you want to do as a newlywed, make coffee in the morning. And she'd call and she'd cheer us up, and she'd say, you know, breakfast is ready. And so I would try and get, if I would get up and quietly, make coffee and say, oh, I'm sorry, I made it, you know, I already have it made. But it was actually, I guess it worked out all right. The thing when Bill went to service back. He was called. He was an inactive Marine and called back during the Korean War. She was looking more for a daughter, and I was looking for, you know, to run my own house type thing. And it wasn't really our furniture as such, so.
Mm-hmm.
But,
It's a bit of a clash.
Hmm?
Was it a bit of a clash?
Not really. I just let it go. It was just like, inside, I was a little bit of unhappiness, I guess you might say, but it wasn't what I planned. And so our first St. Patrick's Day, when he came home from work, I served the meal, and he said, "What is this?" And I said, "Mashed potatoes." He said, "The green." I said, "It's St. Patrick's Day," and he wouldn't eat them. They didn't taste the same green. Mm. So. But then eventually, his parents decided they would move back to Brooklyn, where they were more comfortable in the Polish neighborhood. Their mm-hmm. own grocery store was there and stuff, and so we moved to our own apartment and
mm-hmm.
had our first dog. We never had a pet, actually. We had a bird, maybe. But I was not going to have a dog sleep with me in my bed. No way. Mm-hmm. So the dog would be kind of tied up to the doorknob. And he would kind of run and try and jump on the bed, but miss because it wasn't far enough.
Yeah.
So we went to walk it one night. Somebody said, "Oh, this is the dog that makes all the noise."
Mm-hmm.
So I said, "I couldn't." Yeah. So I let it go after that. If she slept with us, she did. So, but it was so. And then he got graduated, I guess, and had.
What was his degree in? From night school, you're talking about?
He graduated, yeah, for night school.
What was his degree in?
Marketing. Would it be? No, wouldn't it be a BS? It be?
Bachelor of Science?
Bachelor of Science, I guess, yeah. And then he got a job with S&H Green Stamps. And then by that time, I was like, I think 30. He was like a few months younger. So we had a chance to buy a Levitt house when we found out we were pregnant. We used to go look and we'd buy, like, stop in and have lunch and have three hot dogs, one for the dog,
mm-hmm,
one for each
mm-hmm.
of us. But so before we bought the house, he asked if, you know, he would be transferred. They said no, you know. So we bought the house. Nice. It was like a two-bedroom, and it had a fireplace that went from the kitchen into the living room, pardon me. A lot of land, really nice. And in those days, you didn't take your child out until it was christened, and usually you didn't christen it for 30 days, so it was people. I guess my best friend came down from Yonkers, and we had a christening anyhow. So I guess Peter was like maybe 6 months old, and found out, he came home and said that he was being transferred to Pennsylvania to start opening stores for S&H Green Stamps. So here we are with this new little house that we paid $11,000 for, which is, I understand, had been selling a few years ago for like 250,000. People had redone the attic to make two more rooms to it. Great mm-hmm. piece of property. But anyhow, so my friend Mary came down from Yonkers, and she came with us, and we moved out, and we got out. Peter had a high fever. And the kitchen in this little apartment, this two-family house, had these, like a built-in nook. There was a chair, you know, against the wall and the table.
Mm-hmm.
And so the furniture didn't come. And when he called them over, they said that the truck was, they had some trouble and they couldn't deliver until the next day.
You have 1 minute.
So the moving company.
You have 1 minute. Okay, go ahead. Keep going.
Oh, keep talking. All right, so the moving company said they couldn't deliver our stuff that night. So the moving company put us up in a hotel in Pennsylvania. And so, and then the next day we got a doctor to come, and it was just, I guess it was a bad cold or something. So, but that was a nice place to live. Bill traveled Monday to Friday, opening stores for S&H and hiring people and making sure the stock was sent. And so then, by this, when people